Newton's third law is probably the most interesting of the three laws because it represents a certain symmetry in nature, that is, force always occurs in pairs, and one body cannot exert a force on another without experiencing a force itself. So, consider a book which is leaning against a wall. What is obvious in this setup is that the book is exerting some force on the wall. And let's label it as force of book on the wall. Now, what is not so obvious in this setup is that the wall is also putting an equal force on the book, but in the opposite direction. So let's label this force as wall on the book. So this is exactly what Newton's third law of motion says. That is, if there are two bodies interacting, in this case, book and the wall, then if one body exerts a certain force on the second body also exerts the same force on the first body, but in the opposite direction. So, going by Newton's third law of motion, we can say that force of wall on the book should equal the force of book on the wall. And since they are opposite in direction, we'll have to put a negative sign next to one of these. So, let us follow the sign convention like always, and if we take this as a positive direction, then we can put a negative sign to this one. Also, if they are equal and opposite, the vector sum should become zero, and that is exactly what happens when we put this negative sign here. The sum becomes zero. In another example, let's say a box is sitting on a table. And what you can see here again is that the box is putting a certain force on the table and it's acting in the downward direction. And let's call this force box on the table. And if you go by Newton's third law of motion, there should be an equivalent opposing force, which in this case is a force that the table is exerting on the box. And it should be in the reverse direction. So, let's label that force in the upward direction and we will call this force of table on the box. So we have successfully marked the force pairs for this situation. And these force pairs are often termed in a more scholarly way as equal and opposite action-reaction force pairs. Some like calling it Newton's third law force pairs. So, we can say that FBT, or the force of book on the table, is equal to FTB, or the force of table on the book. But since this force is acting in this direction, we put a negative sign here, which also goes to show that it's acting in a direction opposite to the other force. And if you bring both the forces on one side, you get force of table on the book plus the force of book on the table is equal to zero. Clearly showing that the two forces are adding up to zero, and that is the reason the box is stationary. Another very important thing you would have noticed in the two examples I've just given is that the pair of forces never act on the same body. So, what you have to remember is that when there are two interacting bodies, one force would act on one body, and the other force should act on the interacting body. You can never have a situation where both forces act on the same body. And if they are, then you cannot call them action-reaction pairs. Let's take another example where there's no physical contact, yet Newton's third law of motion is coming into play. And what you'll consider is this ball interacting with the earth. So what you can see is that the ball is getting attracted towards the earth, in fact, towards the center of the earth with a certain force that is nothing but the product of mass and gravity. So let's label this force which is acting on the ball in the downward direction and let's call this the force due to earth on the ball. But Newton's third law of motion says that there should be an equal and opposing force, and in this case, it's actually the force with which the ball is attracting the earth towards itself. And this is equal and opposite in the direction to this force. And let's go ahead and label this force as force due to ball on earth. So once again, we can write the equation force of earth on the ball is equal to the force of ball on the earth. And we'll have to put a negative sign again over here to show that they are equal and opposite forces. Now, some of you might say that if the ball is exerting a force on Earth, why does the Earth not move? And that would be a reasonable question. And the answer to it would surprise you that actually the Earth moves because of the force exerted by the ball. However, this displacement is so small that it is hardly noticed by you. So, I've included some calculations in the description below to show by what distance the Earth actually moves when a ball falls towards it. So, now let us work on a situation that you will very often encounter when solving numerical problems, and therefore it is very important to understand this part. So, what we have here are two boxes lying on top of a table. Say, one of the boxes is 4 kilograms and the other is 6 kilograms. And now, we exert a force of 10 Newton on the 4 kilogram mass. And we are asked to find what is the acceleration of each box or the acceleration of the system. Now, how you should approach such problems is to first draw a free body diagram of both the masses. So, let us go ahead and make the free body diagram for the 4 kilogram mass first. Well, one of the forces acting on it that is quite clear is 10 newtons in this direction. But we can also see that the 4 kilogram mass is exerting a force on the 6 kilogram mass, and as a result, according to Newton's third law, there should be an equal and opposite force acting on the 4 kilogram mass due to the 6 kilogram mass. So let's label this force as F6 force, or the force exerted by the 6 kilogram mass on the 4 kilogram mass. Now we will draw a similar free body diagram for the 6 kilogram mass, and what you'll find is there's only one force acting on it, and that's due to the 4 kilogram mass. So let's label this force as F46, or the force acting due to the 4 kilogram mass on the 6 kilogram mass. But we also know that from Newton's third law that when two bodies are interacting, the force acting on each other is equal in magnitude but opposite in direction. So the magnitude of F46 and F64 should be the same. So let's label these as just F instead of F64 and F46. So here are the free body diagrams of both the masses. Now, some of you might think, why have we not taken this force that is exerted by the 4 kilogram mass on the 6 kilogram mass? And the simple answer is that when you draw a free body diagram, you only mark the forces acting on the object and not what the object is exerting on any other mass or object. Now, let's go ahead and write the equation F net is equal to ma for each mass. So, for the 4 kilogram mass, on the left hand side, what you'll get is a force of 10 Newton acting in the right direction, and we take it as positive, and the force small f acting in the left direction, so we will label it minus f. And this should equal its mass, which is 4 kilograms, into the acceleration, which is a result of this force. Now, if you write a similar equation for the 6 kilogram mass, you have only one force, that is F, and this should equal 6 into the acceleration A. Now, you notice, I've taken same value of acceleration for both 4 kilogram mass as well as the 6 kilogram mass. And this makes sense because if the 6 kilogram mass had a different acceleration, let's say it was more than A, then what would happen is that the 6 kilogram mass would kind of run away from the 4 kilogram mass and there'll be no interaction. But here the premise is that there is an interaction. Likewise, if the acceleration of 6 kilogram mass was less than A, then it would actually crash into the 4 kilogram mass. So the fact is that both the masses are moving with the same acceleration A, and the whole system is also moving with the same acceleration. Now let's go ahead and add these two equations and solve for acceleration A, and what you get is A is equal to 1 meters per second square. And if we substitute the value of A in equation 2, we can also find the force of interaction, or simply the force exerted by each box on each other. And that would equal 6 Newton. Now, let's analyze each mass separately and check if we got the right answers. So on the 4 kilogram mass, you have a 10 Newton force acting in this direction, and we've just found that there's a force of 6 Newton, that is small f, acting in this direction. So we can say that the net force acting on the 4 kilogram mass is 4 Newton, that is 10 minus 6, and in the right direction. And if we equate it with its mass and acceleration, what you'll find is A is equal to 1 meters per second squared. So we did get the right answer here. Likewise, if you take the 6 kilogram mass, the only force acting on this mass is small f, or 6 Newtons. And if you put it in F is equal to ma, you'll get 6 Newtons on the left hand side, which is equal to mass into acceleration. And what you find is that acceleration is equal to 1 meters per second squared, what you calculated earlier. Okay, another important thing to clarify is that I have seen some students think that since 10 Newton force is acting on the 4 kilogram mass, it's acting on 6 kilogram mass as well. And the reason they give is that this 10 Newton force is being transmitted through the 4 kilogram box. This is not correct. These are two separate interactions. One is the force of 10 Newton on the 4 kilogram mass, and the other is between 4 kilogram and the 6 kilogram mass. Therefore, the only force acting on the 6 kilogram mass is due to the 4 kilogram mass. So what you need to remember here is that when you draw a free body diagram, just include the forces which are acting on the body. Do not invent your own forces. Do not add forces which are not acting. So if you want to become a force Jedi, don't forget to check out this playlist on Newton's laws. Also, please give that thumbs up button some action and reaction. That'll be helpful. And see you in the next lesson.